Good morning. Today we are going to revise architecture structure 1. So what is architectural structure? We are going to study the basic idea about the strength of material. Now what is the strength of material? We have studied the various types of structure. We have studied the various types of load. We have studied how to draw the shear force and the bending moment diagram. We have studied the various elastic constraints. Today I will give you the brief what are the various types of elastic constraints. Just go through it and just revise it 1, 2, 3, or 4, how many times you will revise it. So we will start with the first topic. First topic what we have studied is stress and strain. We have studied stress and strain. First thing what we have studied there is a material. What will happen to this material? First, what will come? I have told you, strain will come. Because stress is what? Stress is the internal resistance that is against some load. Suppose this is P, this is which type of load? This is tensile load. So if there is some tensile load or if there are any compressive load, the body tends to change its shapes. So that will have some stress and strain in it. So first what will come? Strain will become. Strain will be equal to change in length divided by original length. Now due to this strain, we will have some stress. Stress is what? I have told you, load per unit area. Area will be cross-sectional area. I have told you why it is. This is known as what? Engineering stress or engineering strain. Now what is? I have told you what is true strain and what is true stress. If we are going to take the true strain, this is what? Change in length at particular instantaneous length. That is the total length what we are going to take. Again, the instantaneous or true stress is what? Load divided by instantaneous area on which we are going to consider. Now, what is the difference between instantaneous and what is the difference between engineering? Instantaneous is that point at a particular point. Suppose we are going to take at this point. No, now it is not possible in case of what we are going to study. In strength of material, we are not going to take at the instantaneous. So we are going to consider what? Engineering stress or engineering strain. So we will take this value. Now what is the relationship between that? Them is epsilon T will be given by epsilon 1 plus mu. This is the relationship between the true stress and true strain and engineering strain. So we can directly find out the relationship between them. This is what we will find out. Now this is what the basic idea about the stress strain. Now coming to the elastic constraints. Now what are the elastic constraints? What are the elastic constraints? Have you studied any elastic constraints? Hooke's law. What Hooke say? Hooke say stress is directly proportional to strain. Now while we are going to remove this proportional constraint, we will have some constant that is known as E. E is what? Modulus of elasticity. This is what? The elasticity constraint. So for like this, there are 3 or 4 constraints. So we have to study them. In the second unit, you will have the various constraints and what is the relationship between them. So this is the modulus of elasticity, which is given by stress upon strain. So the ratio between the stress and the strain is known as constant. Now like this, there is one more constant that is known as modulus of rigidity, that is denoted by G, which is equal to shear strain divided by shear stress divided by the shear strain. This is what? This is known as modulus of rigidity. What do you mean by modulus of rigidity? If the material is having minimum strain, it will have maximum rigidity. It will be shown that the material is rigid. That's why we are going to say that this is modulus of rigidity, which is going to be defined as shear stress divided by the shear strain. This is what the relationship you have. Now again, one more constant is bulk modulus. This is defined as the normal stress divided by the volumetric strain. This is the relationship between the bulk modulus. So this will directly depend on the normal stress divided by the change in or strain in volumetric strain, you can say that. So this is what you have. Now these are the 3 constants you are going to use. So there may be some relationship between them. So you have to find out that relationship. You are going to directly remember the relationship between them. So one more, 1, 2, 3, and 4th one is, that is Poisson's ratio. Have you heard about the Poisson's ratio? What is Poisson's ratio? Poisson's ratio is lateral strain divided by longitudinal strain. Are you getting what is lateral? What is mu? If suppose this is your member, you will apply force P. This is tensile force. What will happen to your material? It will try to elongate. What will happen? It will try to move like this. There maybe if the force is increasing, the material is trying to elongate along the length. But there are some changes in this diameter also. Yes. That is what known as lateral strain. This strain is what? Longitudinal strain, because it is in the length direction. That's why this strain is known as longitudinal and this is known as lateral. So the ratio of lateral to the longitudinal is known as Poisson's ratio. This is what 4 elastic constants you have. This is the 4 constants. Now you have to remember the relationship between them. Just try to write the relation and just remember the relation directly. E is equal to 2g 1 plus mu. First relation, E is 3k 1 minus 2 mu. Third one is E is 9kg divided by 3k plus g. This is what the relationship between them. Mu will be equal to 3k minus 2g by k minus g. This is what the relationship between them. This is the direct relationship you will have. Or this is 3k minus 2g or 6k minus g. This is what the relationship between the... You have to directly remember this relationship. This is the relationship between all the elastic constants. This is what E, modulus of elasticity. Suppose the question will be asked to you that what will happen if the... What is the relationship between modulus of elasticity and modulus of rigidity if Poisson's ratio is 0.5. There will be some relationship between, suppose the value, what is Poisson's ratio? It is the lateral strain divided by the longitudinal strain. So that there may be some range of that. That is minus 1 to 0.5. This is the range in which the Poisson's ratio is vary. It may be it for the different substances. Suppose there is cork, plastic or any other material are there. So it will have a particular value. So this is the range what we have. Suppose we will take 0.5. Suppose Poisson's ratio is 0.5, then what will happen to this relationship? 0.5 will be what? Suppose you will take this relationship. 0.5 is 2, 0.5 is 1, 1 minus 1 is 0. So what is the relationship between E and K? Is E is equal to 0. So if you will say that if the maximum velocity of Poisson's ratio, then the modulus of elasticity will be equal to 0. It means that the material is... What? If elasticity is 0, the material is not elastic. So this is what the relationship it will have. Why we are going to find out the elastic constants of a material? Because we have to define the material, which type of material we have. So this is why we are going to use the elastic constants. This is the basic idea about the elastic constant. And you have in the exam also it will become what is the relationship between the modulus of elasticity and modulus of rigidity? What is the relationship between modulus of elasticity and bulk modulus? So you have to just... If you want to derive it, you can derive, or if you just keep it and you have defined what is E, what is G, so that will be sufficient. So because it is given what is the relationship between modulus of elasticity and modulus of rigidity, that's why this is the relation has been given to you. This is what the elastic constant we are going to use in our material, because every material will have some different value. According to that, we will have various... Suppose we will know the value of... These are the 4 constants we have: E, G, K and mu. If we know 2 of them, we can find the other 2. So independent constants are 2 only. We can find out with the help of, if K and mu has been given to you, we can directly put and find the value of E. So this is the relation that will going to help us. So this is what we will find out, the property of material. This is what about elastic constants and the stress and strain. Now coming to one more thing, stress and strain curve, the most important part. Or something you will have also solved numerical on the elongation. What is delta? Delta is PL upon AE. This is what that, this will depend on the load, what is acting on your body. This is P, and you will directly find out the PL upon AE. This is what the elongation you will get. You have solved the numerical also. Now one more thing will be there. If there is self weight of this member, we have solved only that when the load is there. If there is W, self weight is also there, then the formula will be WL upon 2AE. This is what the change you will have when there is self weight. So this is what the formula you have solved the questions also. Now coming to one more thing, stress and strain curve. What is stress and strain curve? Now the question arises, why we are going to draw the stress strain curve? And which type of material what we are going to study? We have studied two types of, or various types of material. The material may be ductile or the material may be brittle. But we have to study only what, which type of material? We have to study the ductile material. We have plot the curve of ductile material. That is like this. So, but what is the curve for the brittle material? It will be like this. This is the for brittle material. So this is the curve for brittle. This is the curve for ductile. We have to study the ductile material. Why we are going to study the ductile? Because in the strength of material, we are going to use the ductile material only. Because that will have more ductility. So we can use in our construction purpose. So for ductility purpose, this is the point of upper yield. This is lower yield. This is maximum or ultimate stress, or this is the point of fracture. This is proportional limit. Now I have told you, suppose the curve has been drawn in stress and strain. Now can you tell me what should be the area, suppose this is proportional limit, what should be the area in between them? What we have called this area, do you remember? What area you will call this? What? Area I am asking. Area will be what? Half into base into height. Suppose stress multiplied by strain. Okay, before that, you if you will draw the curve for P and delta. This is elongation, this is your load. So I have told you, suppose this is your curve. Whatever the curve will be there for stress strain. Suppose you will find out for the proportional limit. This curve will be known as half into P into delta. Now P into delta will be what? This is the unit of load is Newton per meter square, and the delta is what? Delta is the elongation, delta will be in meter. So meter will be answered, it will be Newton per meter, or it is known as joule. This is what the energy absorbed in your curve is. This is known as what? This is known as resilience. I have told you. Suppose you have elongated your material, the material is elongated and there is some resistance that is provided, or that is going to be, that is trying to try to hold that elongation. So what is that in material? There is some energy. So energy in the form of resilience. This is what the resilience energy is already stored in your material. So while drawing the curve between P and delta, you will have some resilience. So this is below the elastic limit. If it is up to the elastic limit, it is known as what? Proof resilience. If it is up to the elastic limit, it is known as proof resilience. If it is below the elastic limit, it is known as resilience. Now when the curve has been drawn in your stress and strain, it is what? Half sigma. This is Newton per meter square, or multiplied by meter. It will be what? It will be the unit of, it will be energy per volume. This is meter cube, this is Newton meter, energy per unit volume. So this is known as modulus of resilience. So while you are drawing the curve between the stress and strain, this is known as modulus of resilience. These are the three things you have to take the most important part of that curve. So stress strain curve has been completed, elastic constant has been completed. Now we have studied the various types of structure, we have studied various types of material what we are going to use. This is what the first unit we have, introduction to the structures, materials, mechanical properties, and all the things has been completed. Now coming to the second unit, what are the structural elements? What are the various structural elements? Beam, column, slab, foundation or footing. These are the basic structural elements that we are going to use in our structure. Now coming to third unit, third is what elastic constraint, what we have done here. These are the elastic constraints that we are going to use in our structures. Okay, these are the basic elastic constraints. Second is what is the relationship between them, modulus of elasticity, and we have the find out the four relationship that is most important. Now coming to the center of gravity. Now what is the center of gravity? Suppose there is a body, suppose there is a rectangular body. The center of gravity is what, where the whole mass of that body is going to be at. Why we are going to study the center of gravity? Because we have used the center of gravity while solving the SFD BMD. We have find out, suppose there is a rectangular section, we will take the CG at the center. In triangle, we will take the CG as x by 3 or 2 by 3, whether it is from the base, whether it is from the perpendicular side. This is why we are going to find out the center of gravity. Because if there is a material that is going to be used in our structure, we have to know where the CG of that body is going to be at. So we will have some numerical on basis of that. So I am going to rub this. I have given you the numerical also. Suppose there is a numerical for I section. Why we have taken the I section? Because in our structure we can use this directly, we can use this as a beam. Suppose this is your horizontal part, this is the vertical part, this is again the horizontal part. So we have to know how to find out the center of gravity of this part. So whatever has been given to you, suppose 150, this is 10, again this is 10. So the length and the breadth has been given to you, whatever it may be given to you. Suppose 200 and anything you can take. This is 300. So what you have to do, you will take the section. Suppose this is your first, this is second, this is third. Now I will ask what should be the CG of this whole structure. This is a rectangular, this is also rectangular, and then this is rectangular. You have to divide it like this. Again this. This is a rectangle, this is also a rectangle, this is also a rectangle. Now what is this center of gravity of this point? X bar will be what? A1 multiplied by X1, A2 multiplied by X2 divided by A1 plus A2. This is how we are going to find out the center of gravity. Now we have to see that the figure is symmetrical or not. This figure is symmetrical. If you will cut it from here, you will get a symmetry. Same side. So this is symmetrical. Now you have to see that this is going to be symmetrical on what axis. Suppose you will take this x axis, you will take this y axis. So this is symmetrical about y axis. So it is symmetrical about y axis. So x will not be there. There will be only y bar. So y bar will be what? A1 y1 plus A2 y2 divided by A1 plus A2. If it is symmetrical about the x axis, then only x bar will be there. It is clear? But if it is not symmetrical, then you will have x bar and y bar both. It is clear? Now while solving the or while finding the CG, you have to take some reference. You can take any reference. You can take this reference, or you can take this reference, or you can take this reference. It should depend on you. You have to mention in the answer that this is the center of gravity while taking the base as a, suppose you will take AB, so AB will be the reference. You have to mention that reference. Here we are going to take the reference AB. Can you tell me what is A1, what is Y1, what is A2, what is Y2? A1 is what? Suppose you have taken this one. A1 is area of the rectangle. What should be the area? Area will be 150 multiplied by 10. It is clear? Now can you tell me what is Y1? Y1 is again, that is the CG that is acting with respect to your reference. Now A1 is here. Y1 is what? Y1 is again here. Y1 is CG of this. Y1 will be the CG of this. So this is A1. Y1 will be 10 divided by 2. This is 5. Now you have to take from here. Suppose this is 200. Again this will be 10. So you have to take the distance from here. This is 10, this is 300, 310 plus 5, that will be 315. Are you getting what I am saying? It is clear. Now again find out A2 and Y2. A2 is what? A2 is again 300 multiplied by 10. Now what is the Y2? Y2 is again the CG of this plus this. So this is 300. 300 divided by 2 is 150. 150 plus 10, that is 160. It is clear? There is one more thing will be there, A3, Y3 plus A3, because three figures are there, so you have to find out the A3 and Y3 also. So A3 will be 200 multiplied by 10. What should be the CG of this? This will be multiplied by 5, because the reference is here, you are taking reference. Now A1 is 150 into 10 plus 300 into 10 plus 200 into 10. This is what you will get the center of gravity of this figure. This is what the center of gravity, how you are going to find out. Now there is one more thing has been given to you, how to find out the moment of inertia. This is what the CG you have find out. Now if there are so many complex figures while solving for the structure, so there will be so many structures will be there, suppose triangle will be there. So first you have to remember the CG of all the figures. After that, what you have to do, suppose this figure has been shifted here. Suppose this I section will not having the symmetry, it will be like this, or it will be something else. So you have to solve it with the help of parallel axis theorem. Now what is parallel axis theorem? It is given by, suppose you have to find out the moment of inertia for IYY, it will be IXX plus A multiplied by H square. Now what is this? Suppose this figure has been continued like this. It may be channel section or it may be angle section may be there. So how? Suppose you have find out the moment of inertia here. So you will draw the parallel axis like this. The distance between the parallel axis, that is what H, between that axis where you are going to take. So this is what, suppose you have to find out this YY and this is your XX. So the moment of inertia with respect to this axis will be what? This plus area multiplied by this H distance. This is what the moment of inertia for the parallel axis theorem. With the help of parallel axis theorem you can find out, but this is not going to come in your exam. You will get the question of the center of gravity, how to find out the center of gravity. It may be for different various section, it may be I section, it may be L section. It is not compulsory that you will get only Y bar, you will have X bar and Y bar both. This is what about the third unit you will have center of gravity, moment of inertia, center of gravity of simple theorem of parallel axis theorem. Now this is what about fourth unit. Now coming to shear force bending moment diagram. Now I am going to revise whatever we have studied in the shear force and bending moment diagram. Now what is shear force? What is shear force? Shear force is what? All the vertical force that is acting on the section, whether it is in left, whether it is in right, all the vertical force that is acting on your section, that is known as shear force. Now what is bending moment? Bending moment is what? Any moment that is acting on your section, whether the left or the right of the section. So we have started the SFD BMD with dm by dx. This is what the differentiation of bending moment with